like tied away. You guys know what I'm talking about. There's a 15-page paper due. I had a speaking word conference. I needed to speed read a Dallas Willard book. And all the while, my kids are saying, "Hey, Mom, what's for dinner?" And so I remember that day, I felt really overwhelmed. So I thought, you know what? I'm just going to go for a walk and I'm going to clear my head. But I made it to the end of the driveway before I plopped down on the ground and just full on laid on my back as if I was going to do snow angels on the pavement. And so my kids, I think, were watching this scene kind of play out through the window and probably wondering if I was losing my marbles. And so a few minutes later, they come outside, my two oldest girls, and they say, "Mom, are you doing okay?" You counselors probably have a word for what was happening to me at the time. And I said, "Yeah, I'm just talking to God about all the stuff I've got to do." And they said, "Okay." And just rode off on their bikes. And so I'm guessing if you're in this room, if you're in a robe and a cap and gown, you've had a moment like this over the past couple years, a moment where you thought, how in the world am I going to just keep all these plates in the air and keep these plates spinning? And in between work responsibilities and kids' soccer games and getting ready for Sunday for those of us in ministry, in between all those things, somehow, every free block of space in our calendar, we decided we should squeeze in a chapter of reading. And probably, I bet every commute that you've had for the past couple of years, you have been listening to some narrator speak to you at 2.5 times speed, you know, the rate that any human being can understand information. But we did this so we could do this journey, so we could get these books read and these experiences under our belt. You know, before long, some of these stressors and some of these assignments, they started causing us to dive into new conversations. They started to challenge us in the way that we saw God and experienced Him, the way that we understood ourselves. You know, academia can bring this fear and inadequacy. Sometimes that'll just bubble up in you. But eventually, those fears and inadequacies were just replaced by some new truths, by some transformative truths. And truths that we're going to take from this day forward. Last week, we had one of our last online classes. We did a lot of Zoom classrooms in the school of ministry. And so I got to sit with some of my peers, and I got to hear some of the truths that they've experienced over these past couple years. And I heard some pretty remarkable things. Things that sounded like this. "I have learned that I cannot know God fully, but I can know Him truly. I now know that we can't flourish apart from rest and silence and solitude." We were introduced to practices like the prayer of examine and Lectio Divina, and we were introduced to ways that the Holy Spirit could illuminate things in our lives that God was already doing. We experienced the spiritual disciplines, and not as legalistic rituals, but actually as avenues to open up ourselves to God. And these are truths that have marked us and truths that we're going to carry forward on this journey into our ministries and our communities, into our lives. See, when Jesus was on the earth about 2,000 years ago, His teachings and His actions marked others. And His disciples, they were the ones who got to see up close and personal these miracles, these interactions. You know, wherever He went, He attracted a crowd. And you guys know the story that we find in John, where there's a countryside just full of people. They say that it outnumbered 5,000. And they're hungry, and there's nothing to eat. And the disciples look at it, and they're perplexed, and they don't know what to do. But He says, "Hand me those 5 little loaves and those 2 little fish." And He took it, the only available resources that He had, and He gave thanks to God, and He distributed it to those who were seated. And the scripture says that they had as much as they wanted. The text goes on to say, "And when everyone was full, He said to His disciples, 'Gather the pieces that are left over so that nothing is wasted.'" So they collected all the leftovers. You know the rest of the story. There were 12 baskets full. And every time I read that passage, you know, we're amazed by Jesus' provision. We're amazed how He met the needs of the people who were right there. We're amazed how He went to them. And we read that they were amazed, and that many of them believed. They knew He was the Son of God. But there's another detail. Every time that Jesus allowed the disciples to carry the baskets. See, they got to be up close and personal to the miracle. They got to see the abundance of his work. They got to be the conduit between his people and their Savior. And as pastors and leaders and as counselors, we get to do the same thing. We get to carry the basket to the hungry and to the hurting, to the lost, to the broken, to the unbelieving. And we get a front row seat to the life that only Jesus brings. And so maybe there will be a time that we'll get to hand off some of these awesome insights that we've learned over the past couple of years. But more importantly, I know there will be a time when we have a chance to point people who need it most, people in our churches and our communities and maybe in your counseling offices. We will be able to point them to the one who offers life. And so it is a high honor and it's a privilege to serve as pastors and leaders and counselors and to carry Jesus to a hurting and broken world. So today, fellow students, fellow co-laborers, today we just get to embrace God's goodness. We get to rest and play and celebrate this transformative journey that we've been on. But tomorrow we go back to our homes, into our communities, into our churches, into our families. And tomorrow, remember to carry the basket.